Are we sitting comfortably? Are the lights turned down low and the shadows lengthening in the room? Are the curtains closed and are the doors locked? Good. Then let us begin.
RAF Full Sutton was a Class A standard airfield built in the parishes of Full Sutton and Fangfoss, 9 miles from York. It opened in May 1944 into No. 4 Group Bomber Command as part of No. 42 base under the parent station at Pocklington, and with No. 77 Squadron arriving from Elvington with Halifaxes. They continued in main force operations until July 1945, when No. 77 Squadron was transferred to Transport Command and exchanged the Halifaxes for Douglas Dakotas, before moving to RAF Broadwell at the end of August. The airfield remained operational within Transport Command for Avro Lancastrian training until training ceased on the 28th of March 1946. The airfield was retained, and in the early 1950s, No. 103 Flying Refresher School, and then as No. 207 Advanced Flying School, were based there. But this usage was brief, and the airfield was then placed on care and maintenance until 1959, when it had a brief reprieve as a Thor missile base. On the 27th of April 1963, RAF Full Sutton closed for good. The airfield is now used in part as Full Sutton Airfield, being home to the Full Sutton Flying Centre, while another part of the site houses Full Sutton Prison. 95 Halifaxes failed to return or were lost in crashes during wartime operations flown from RAF Full Sutton. Bruce Barrymore Halpenny writes in his third Ghost Stations volume about the experience on the airfield of Peter Giles in February 1965. Peter Giles and his mate set out in their lorry to deliver a greenhouse to a farm near Stamford Bridge in East Yorkshire. It is said to have been a dull, murky day and was raining hard when they arrived at their destination. By the time they had unloaded the greenhouse, they were soaked to the skin and it was dark. At 17:30 they started for home using road directions from the farmer, which entailed following the lane for Fangfoss and Pocklington, the road which crossed Full Sutton Airfield. Driving across the airfield, the buildings of the old domestic site were illuminated by the headlights, and having roughly crossed half of it, two figures dressed in World War II SIGCOT suits, flying boots, flying helmets and parachutes hanging behind them, suddenly appeared in the beams of the headlights. One was described as carrying a long green holdall. Peter slowed down and watched as they crossed the road in front of them, casting no shadow from the headlights, and although it was still raining hard, they appeared quite dry. He stopped and watched the two figures enter a large Nissan hut to his right. He felt a strong urge to follow the figures. His mate, however, did not want to. So grabbing a torch, he got out of the lorry and walked to the Nissan hut. Once inside, he shone the torch's beam around and saw that the floor was covered in debris, with some wall and ceiling panels hanging loose. Apart from an old iron round stove lying on its side at one end, it was otherwise completely empty. There was no trace of the two airmen, no wet footprints on the floor apart from his. Then he noticed another double door and a short passage to a second Nissan hut, which he then went to and found himself in a room with a low platform and a large map of Europe on the wall. At this point, he had the overwhelming sense of being watched, not by a single pair of eyes, but many. He exited the hut, as he says, sharpish, and went back to the lorry, got in, and drove off in silence. In 1986, the north end of the airfield was selected as a site for a men's high security prison, which opened in 1988 as HMP Full Sutton. Ray wrote to me on the 17th of July 2012 detailing some events at Full Sutton Prison. The story that Ray had heard when he arrived as a prison warder over 25 years ago was that an airman had walked in front of a plane that had just started its engines and the props hit his head. In the time that Ray was at the prison, there was much talk around the prison about what was called our resident. Perhaps in the 1990s, when Ray was on night duty on a wing with one other person, they took it in turns to press a number of buttons on the wing throughout the night, proving on computer that they were checking all areas as required. His colleague did his rounds, returning to the office, and asked Ray to follow him to one of the television rooms as he needed to see something. Ray did this, and he was shown that the television was still switched on in the room. Ray assumed that they had missed this in their preliminary checks, a not unusual thing, but then his colleague asked him to follow the mains lead from the set to the plug socket, where he saw it was not plugged in. Many prisoners, on two of the wings in particular, had complained of strange noises, of footsteps, of lights turning on and off, and of extreme cold, and actually blaming the warders for winding them up. Ray stated that they have certain regular night staff who had refused to work on these wings. In another account from the prison, a dog handler was at one side of an interior wire fence where, being a top security prison, all the alarm and camera measures were in place and being monitored. The handler was filmed on his patrol. However, the infrared cameras also recorded a dark figure on the other side of the wire fence, apparently following him, just a few feet behind. This figure should have been visible to him. The staff in the control room called him and asked him to check his surroundings, which he did, but he saw no one there, and more importantly perhaps, his dog did not indicate or react to another presence either. If the alarms on the fence had picked up another person in the area, the alarms would sound in the control room, but the alarms didn't react to this figure either. Although RAF Full Sutton has closed, it seems that nobody has told the aircrew.